Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Welcome at our first webinar from ChessWise. For us, it's a new experience. We expect it to be at Light and Building this week. Of course, I think most of you did expect to be there, to go there. But due to the coronas, everything is different today. So I hope you're all well. And I hope we can use this hour to inform you with things and ideas we already wanted to present you online and building, but we decided to do it today and not to wait until the end of September. So very much welcome. We're going to start with some with an introduction about ChessWise, because not everybody has logged in yet, although we are with many, around 50 already at this moment, I believe, in different countries, different continents. So it's very nice and good for us to learn. There's a lot of interest in what we are doing. Let me introduce Wim Hooghout. We do say hello today.
It's the Dutch handshake.
Like this. And Joost Toornent, he is doing the technical department, and if everything is going well, you can ask questions and we will see how we can answer them during this webinar. So first of all, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the history of ChessWise, because we started already 30 years ago with developing hardware and software for big industries. Working for Philips, ASML, companies like that, we used our technology to create their own systems and deploy them worldwide, sell them worldwide. ChessWise components were inside their products. Nobody knows, but we are already all over the world. 15 years ago, we decided to do research on wireless networking, because the idea was there will be more and more and more sensors in our world, and the data coming out of the sensors has to be connected somehow. And if you want to do that with wires, it simply doesn't work. It's too costly. And the alternative, wireless, there was no wireless system available other than Bluetooth with a one-to-one connection, or Zigbee, which is very limited, and of course Wi-Fi. And we all know our kids screaming when the Wi-Fi is too slow again. So we thought, as technical guys as we are, we make something on our own, and that is what we call MyMesh today. Wim, maybe you can explain a little bit about the ideas of MyMesh.
Yeah, I will give a brief explanation about MyMesh. What Han explained, the development of the MyMesh proprietary network protocol already started in 2003. It was a cooperation between several electronics and software development companies together with universities from both the Netherlands and Germany, as far as I know, or maybe
yeah,
more.
Yeah, USA as well.
Yeah. And already in 2007, the MyMesh network protocol was operational. And basically the background idea of MyMesh is that it should be able to communicate with thousands of devices in one network, like a swarm of birds or a school of fish, without a central unit. So a distributed intelligence within the network. And already from 2008-2010, Chess started to develop different kind of applications using this MyMesh network protocol, not only in lighting, but also in logistics. And I think, can you tell something about that?
Yeah, yeah.
How did it started with the first lighting application?
Sure, because we didn't knew which direction it would go. We just thought we're going to start with some projects and see where it will bring us. So we started 5 pilot projects, and then I'm in 2013, something like that, 2014. We started 5 pilot projects with real customers, and 3 of them were in lighting and in building automation, and 2 of them were in logistics. That's when we learned how important it is to be in lighting, because lights are everywhere around you. It doesn't matter if you are in a building or in a city or in an industry. If you want to connect sensors and your network is in the light, you are everywhere.
Yeah.
So after this first developments, we decided we're going to focus on lighting in different segments, because for us it doesn't really matter if it is in buildings or in public lighting or in industrial lighting, because the protocol we developed wasn't stick to one radio. We can run on every radio. Doesn't matter if it's Bluetooth, doesn't matter if it's 868 megahertz, the LoRa network. So you can think of different applications with different radios, and that's what we're doing. At the moment, ultra wideband, for instance, is a new radio Apple is pushing. We already did some projects with it in the military field, because at that moment in time, this radio was too expensive to deploy on large scale. But today you see a company of Apple, as Apple is taking the lead with this kind of new radios. And then it's very important to know that the protocol we developed is radio independent.
Yeah. So basically, that's how MyMesh started. And today we are a wireless building automation system for wireless light control and smart building management. Because the network itself is not only for sensoring, but also for control. So it's a wireless sensoring and control solution. Han already explained, it's multitasking, it's radio agnostic with a decentralized intelligence. And I think it's good to express that MyMesh is especially developed for the professional market. So for the large scale professional applications. And that's of course also because the key important network features are its scalability. We can scale up to thousands of nodes within one network. And I think it's very interesting to tell you that our largest single network is currently 5,500 nodes in a public lighting installation.
Yeah, and that's without any central computer organizing things. Yep. This was, by the way, in a city in the Netherlands, and immediately they did win an award, and there was the award being the darkest city of the nation. And that's something which is really important. This light pollution isn't a good idea anymore. So besides scalability, we did a lot on security. Of course, security is an item which becomes more and more important. And the first idea people have when they think or talk about security is, do you something about encryption? And encryption is, of course, part of security, but it's only the beginning. It's something you should do. Everybody does, but it's not really secure. Security is much more in the process. I already said we have a background going back for 30 years. So we did develop the security systems for chip cards from banks. And this same system, the same methodology we used for our network security. I don't want to go into details, but one or two things you have to know is we inject our secret keys as the first thing when power is on a module. This means the secret keys goes in, and afterwards nobody without these keys can enter this module. Nobody is doing that, but we think in the end, this kind of systems, this kind of procedures will make the difference in security. Yeah. One other.
Yeah, that's what we call end-to-end security.
Yeah.
So at the start of production of the MIMESH devices, already the security keys are inserted. Yeah.
Maybe this is also a good moment to answer our first question about proprietary versus open systems. The way we see it is if you're a standard system like, well, doesn't matter who, but let's take Bluetooth. Everybody can enter a system like that because modules are coming in factory mode. You can maybe reset them to factory mode and then the security is ended. We see it as follows. You should not be able to enter this network itself. However, at the borders, and then you're talking about adding sensors or adding dashboards, there you have to be open to others in the market. But the network itself, you should keep it proprietary because it's the only way to be really secure.
Okay, then I move to the next feature. That's what we call robust. As you can see behind, we have our back wall we wanted to use for light and building. So you're the first to see our new back wall with our key features. And robust is in the network itself. When you power up a new network, so when you power a node, you will have ad hoc configuration of the network and all the nodes start to communicate with each other. If you lose nodes in a network due to a power down or whatsoever, the communication will automatically be rerouted to other nodes which are near the communicating device. That's what we call self-healing. We do not have fixed routes of communication within the network. It's fully ad hoc, and that will make it a very robust and scalable solution. The last one, which is adaptive, basically lighting becomes the new IT solution within a building or a city. And with the introduction of IT, that gives you also the opportunity for software updates. And with MIMESH, we have regular software updates to improve the functionality of your network or to add functionality of all kinds of new devices. So basically, this is a summary about MIMESH. And I think it's good to know that we are specialized in various markets, typically indoor, outdoor, and industrial. So that are the three main markets where we offer different product suites specifically for this for these markets. But we will explain more about that later.
Yeah, we have another question. What's the difference between 2.4 gigahertz and 868 megahertz? And 868 megahertz is something we use in Europe, in the US, and in other countries, they use 915 megahertz. The difference is it's the range you can achieve with this different, with these two radios. 2.4 gigahertz is, of course, another wavelength than 868 megahertz. And you can imagine this long 868 wave will reach longer distances. So depending on your application, you have to choose the right radio. Indoor 2.4 gigahertz will do very well most of the times. Outdoor, we use this 868 megahertz radio because we want to cover longer distances. And there's something else going on there. Clients also want this communication infrastructure inside their Luminor. This is started before the Zaga and NEMA connector were became very popular. So they want it inside because they don't want to drill a hole in their luminaire for an antenna outside. Today, Also, if you look, and we will explain later with the new products to the Zaga connector, we use this 868 for outdoor because still these distances are important. In good weather conditions, 2.4 may work, but then when it starts raining or snowing, you might experience problems. So depending on the application, you choose a radio with longer or shorter distances. Yep.
So 2.4 for indoor and 868 for outdoor.
Easy.
Yeah, that's the easy way. So let's get to some news. So over the past years, we have connected over 100,000 MyMesh devices in more than 250 A-level locations. And yeah, we're very happy to see that our new partners also see that we're successful with this application, and that we have shown in the field in operational networks that our features, our network works. So this helps us to expand our ecosystem with new partnerships. So we're happy to announce three new partnerships. The first is a company named Helfer. Helfer is a renowned Finnish company, established already about 100 years ago, who create intelligent lighting solutions. Helfer is active in over 40 countries and are into lighting since the 50s. And Helfer joined the MyMesh ecosystem with their new smart freedom range of compact and linear drivers. Those compact and linear drivers come with a freedom node. And actually a node is a wireless network device. And the freedom node is available with the MyMesh software to cooperate with all the other eco partners and the products available in MyMesh. So we're very happy to announce that together with Helfer, we cooperate in the freedom range. Second is Danlers. Danlers is a UK-based company who design and manufacture energy saving electronics for light controls. They've been doing that for over 20 years, and design and production of the Danlers devices is completely in the UK. They offer a 230 volt powered peer occupancy and light sensors, including an indoor climate sensor for CO2 temperature and relative humidity, all now part of the MyMesh ecosystem. So actually that's quite cool. It's not only a partner on the driver side, so on the power electronics for the luminaires, but also a new partner on the sensor side, being Danlers. Then the third one is Beveco. It's a Dutch company specialized in building automation systems, and their EXWeb, that's the name of their building management cloud platform, is now integrated with the MyMesh management system for monitoring. So with Beveco, we can now offer a MyMesh management system with a really developed platform for monitoring your MyMesh networks. We will explain more about that later. Of course, we do have a partner program.
Yes, Tom? Please. Like to explain you something, because as already stated, we are open at the borders. We are specialized in creating this network platform, MyMesh. And we're not especially interested in creating our own sensors. So The partner program is working with companies creating sensors and wants to add it to third parties like us. That's one. And the other one is we have, of course, distributors in different countries, and we're open for new partners in existing and in countries we're not really active yet. So at this moment, we have partners in the UK, we have partners in France, Denmark, Germany, Spain, also in South America and India. But the world is much larger than this. So if you feel you can contribute bringing MIMES into the world, please contact us and we will reply immediately.
We have a new question. What is your biggest network? I just mentioned that we have a large 868 megahertz network in public lighting, 5,500. Other big examples are a large chemical plant site at Chemelot in Geleen. The largest building is 3,500. So that's an industrial application. More in building applications, the City Hall of Utrecht, about 2000, 1800 to 2000. And yeah, one of the biggest networks abroad and still growing is Blue Water Shopping Mall in London with 2,500 to 3,000 nodes connected already. And this network is still growing. Also in the Netherlands, we have large installs between 1,000 and 2,000 in Erasmus Medical Center in Rotterdam and in Westfield Shopping Mall in Amstelveen. So, we already have shown large operational networks. And of course, there's also the possibility to pay, to do a site visit and to show you how it's in operation.
Maybe okay. We
go to the new stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which one like you like to start with?
Yeah, let's start with indoor.
Okay.
So in the indoor product range, I think that it's good to know that everything what's happening in indoor is about the green transition for a sustainable future for buildings. So of course that's not only on reducing energy consumption, but also on optimizing all kinds of processes within a building. Of course the most important one of those is maintenance. The second one of course is that when you have your network in your building, we want to increase the sensor density, not only for control purposes, for controlling the luminaires, but also to have more information from your building, not only on energy consumption, but also on indoor climate, on all kinds of data of actuators and sensors. So you can develop new information services to increase the performance of your building and to create better business processes within your building. So what's very interesting is that with the electronics marks for luminaire is developing very fast, and with the introduction of Philips Sensor Ready, Osram Dexel, Tridonic, IDPS, and of course that all comes together in the D4i standard. That brings a lot of new data opportunities to the market. Huh? Those smart drivers offer a lot of data, not only on the actual status of the device, so lamp failure, driver failure, status of emergency fittings, function test, duration test, but also on temperatures, voltage, energy consumption, etc. And of course, you need a device that can talk to the driver. So that is.
It's a lot. We have this
and it's very small.
Yes, you can see this doesn't have its own power supply. It's powered by the driver.
We call it the micro BLC.
Yes.
And BLC is building light control.
Luminaire builders are building it in their factories, integrated in their luminaire. And then, I don't know if you can see this, but you can add a sensor to one or to every two or every four, it doesn't matter, to every micro BLC. And these sensors are powered by our micro BLC. The sensor program we have is growing. So today it's PIR in four different
slight motion
requirements,
standard sensitivity, high bay, and horizontal white.
But the next one will be a room temperature. You can put it in the ceiling and it will measure the temperature in your room. It will measure noise. It can measure humidity. And it's all the same system. So very easy, only the micro BLC itself powered by the driver and a sensor which you can add to every luminaire or, only on in the luminaires you need it. And that makes it very cost effective because you don't have to mount sensors to every luminaire, only where you need them.
Okay, yeah. So that is the new micro BLC to connect to the new generation of intelligent drivers with internal DALI supply, DALI power supply.
Yeah, maybe one thing to add for the owner of the building, because we are talking a lot about technical things, but when you're an owner and you want to have a flexible building, you don't want this sensors and other stuff around your building. You only want it in the ceiling, only in your luminaire, because they are fixed. They are on a place which won't change. So whatever happens, you're very flexible to change your walls and don't have to change anything in your infrastructure. And the only thing you have to do then is change your software settings to make a different light plan. Yep. And that's really effective when you own a building and want to make it flexible to optimize the earnings you can have from this building. Same with the data coming out. You can use it as a building owner to optimize your business. And knowing how many people are around, where they are around, if it's quiet in the room, if it's busy serving the users in finding quickly the place they can go to, all that kind of things are very interesting for the owner to optimize his property and rent it as best as possible.
Okay, thanks. So the micro BLC is a new product within our building light control product suite. Of course, we also have the mini BLC, which is a 230 volt power device with a separate antenna. So you can optimize the position of the antenna. And we also have a new question: is RGB, RGBW, or tunable white possible? So the answer is yes. For the communication within the luminaire, we use a DALI. So both the micro BLC and the mini BLC communicate via DALI with the luminaire. And for DALI, we support DALI Type 8 for tunable, so DALI Type 8 drivers for tunable white and RGBW functionality. And I will explain later more on the possibilities for control, for manual control, like dimming, creating scenes, etc.
Okay. And I believe this was Marco's question.
Yeah. Yes,
we have another question about trends in the market. And believe it or not, the big trend is wireless.
That was an easy one.
Yeah, I'm sorry. But that's maybe not the only trend you can see. But when I started in this business, wireless was something people were talking about. 2 years later at the Next Leiden building, people are showing something which was wireless, and the last Leiden building wireless was everywhere. And today, clients are really asking about a wireless system. So that's something which I see is really a breakthrough of the last year. Other trends on the lighting aspect are this tunable white and colors, and in combination with the Arcadian. Because more and more people are asking, clients are asking for a light scheme during the day, copying the daylight outside to create this perfect workspace for their employees. So there are, of course, more, but these are the first ones for me, which pops up.
Yeah, what I see as an important trend in the lighting market is that people are more aware that with the introduction of the new microelectronics in lighting is not a fixed installation anymore. With the possibilities of software updates, it becomes an adaptive system with the ability that during the life cycle of the lighting installation, you can add all kind of functionality, not only on the control aspects, but also on the sensoring and monitoring aspects in a much broader sense than lighting only.
Yeah, and maybe something about functionality, mainly in the UK, but it's coming more and more. We see these demands on monitoring emergency lights automatically from a distance, which is saving a lot of manpower to do this visual inspection. You can do it from the back office. Reports are automatically generated and stored in your back office. Yep. So you are in control of all these emergency lights and know for sure you're within all the rules which are valid in this world.
Yeah. So let's go to outdoor.
Outdoor. Yeah.
Oh, I see we have one more question.
Do you have emergency testing?
Jack,
we have.
Yeah. Well, it's good to tell you that we have implemented the DALI commands on emergency lighting, being performing a function test, duration test, emergency status, battery charge level, emergency burning hours, all kind of those DALI commands we can perform via the different types of modules we have, which enables you to remotely monitoring your emergency lighting. We already do that on a large scale in the UK, where it's a very popular feature of our solution. So, news on outdoor.
Yeah, we have some stuff over here. The trend in outdoor, we started in this world with this indoor control, in-house controller inside the luminaire. But we see the Zaga connector is more and more requested. So, of course, that's the way we go as well. And our latest model, and I'm not sure you can see a lot, but it can be, you can show it, see it on our website otherwise, is with this Zaga connector, and you can connect it on the luminaire. And of course, we will have these sensors which go underneath the luminaire as well as part of the network. So first you create your network with our module, also 868 megahertz. And then when needed, you can add these sensors to control the lights based on movement or well, all the ways the sensor wants to control it.
Yeah.
And of course, you have the possibility to add the network to your back office and control it completely from there.
Yeah, so I think it's very good to know that with the OLCZ, that's our outdoor light controller, which is compliant to Zaga-ready luminaires. You can instantly mount your Zaga module on top of the luminaire. And we already offer via our MyMesh management system calendar control options for scheduling the dim level and the timing of your luminaires. Also, of course, via the communicating with DALI, you have your information, your status reporting for maintenance activities, which is actually the main business case for public lighting, for smart street lighting.
Yes, we have a question about this Zaga.
Yeah,
maybe you can answer that, Toby.
Does Zaga need the D4i interface? So actually, the answer is yes. We focus on development of the OLCZ to be working together with the Zaga D4i. So Zaga and the D4i standard to be able to communicate with the new generation of drivers. So using this Zaga and D4i, it also makes it possible to use not only the OLCZ controller, but also use the Zaga sensors, which so you can create a very dynamic light control solution for outdoor.
Yes, and as explained already, all the security is also part of this outdoor network, so you don't have to bother about nice technical guys who are hacking your public lighting systems. Municipalities can really use this equipment without any fear for hacking and things like that.
So as explained earlier, on our outdoor light control range, we use the 868 megahertz frequency to be able to range a distance between 600 meters and about a kilometer. Especially, this is very large distance, of course, because the module is mounted on top of the luminaire. So we've already done our first install with the OLCZ at Rotterdam at The Hague Airport. So it's very suitable for car parks and cities, for example. Did I just miss the question, Joost? We've done all the questions so far. Okay, so far for outdoor, then let's go to industrial.
Yes, and we didn't talk a lot about dashboards.
Yeah, that's coming later.
Oh, it's coming later.
It's still coming up.
You have to wait a little bit then. Industrial. Yeah. Yes, industrial. We started in the industrial market at Gemelt, where they have luminaires in ATEX zones, and that kind of luminaires, they were not switched off at all because it's not allowed to switch in this explosion dangerous areas. And in the past, they decided, oh, no problem, we switch the light on and it will stay on 24/7. Today, that's not the case anymore. So they were looking for a way to do that different and save energy. More than 90% in this case. And with software, you can switch and dim the lights whenever you want. So the big case there was, we only want to have the light on when light is really needed. This is a project with 14,000 luminaires. So it was really big. It was one of our first projects, and we learned a lot about how to get a network in this specific areas, because steel is influencing your radios a lot, And it's a very difficult area to have a good network. So that's where we learned all the tricks about what do you have to do to get this network really, really robust. And that's benefiting us in a lot of situations, but also in the industrial situation.
Yeah, so what we see in industrial situations, and I'm still getting a few questions on our second screen. One question was, do you use a vertical antenna on the OLSA Z? So the answer is yes. The second one is, I'm not located in the Netherlands. How can I get demos? Well, you can ask us, me and Han, and you can reach us at sales@chess.nl for your questions. And of course, we will respond shortly.
Or if we have a partner in the country you're living, you can go there.
Yeah, or via our request form on the website, you can contact us easily. So let's go back to industrial. What we see in industrial is that there is a large demand for renovation of existing sites, not only in production halls, warehouses, plants, both indoor and outdoor. And of course, that is a high demanding, hazardous environment. So if you look to our standard product, so this is always for integrating inside luminaires, IP20 protection degree, that's not sufficient for an industrial environment. So we have developed a new product, which is this one. And as you can see, it looks completely different, but it is the same, only with the IP54 protection degree, both on the micro BLC and on the peer. So this is a solution for external mount of the micro BLC and PIR for industrial applications. For example, production hall, warehouses. And so what you can see is that actually the product is the same, only the connector is waterproof with a separate connector, and not just the push-in wires you have with the standard micro BLC. Also, the high bay pier looks completely different because it has a protection sleeve to increase the protection degree of the PIR, making it a very solid product.
Yeah, and go on.
And of course, you have to put it all together. So we have specifically designed Y cable to connect the driver, the micro BLC industrial, and the add-on industrial peers.
And by the way, this development was pushed by Sylvain, our partner in France, and it's his birthday today. So Sylvain, congratulations, happy birthday.
Happy birthday. So currently it's orange, it's Dutch design, but the final version will be black.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well,
so let's go to the app. We earlier had the question for tunable white and RGBW. We already support via our MyMesh management system calendar control options, the control and event scheduling of tunable white and RGBW. But in the upcoming release of the commissioning app, it will also be possible to program our remote switch for dim to warm functions on tunable white, and to create four different scenes in a room or in a zone for RGBW. So that's the manual functionality you now can add to your MyMesh network. So then, So we just see we have 45 minutes on. So yeah, we still have the complete management system.
Take another 5 minutes for this MyMesh management system, which is obviously in the cloud. And one of the questions we always get from clients is, oh, in the cloud, our IT department doesn't like the cloud. And some of these clients are asking questions 20 pages long. And when we start to communicate about the way we do it, because we also think this management system in the cloud should be really secure, there's very quickly understanding about what we do, how we do it, and all the arguments which were at the beginning, they disappear immediately. So after a discussion, there were no questions more anymore about, is it safe to be in the cloud? And I haven't seen a client who was rejecting this cloud solution. And one of the other things, and Willem is asking it already, who owns my data? And I think the answer is already in the question. Willem's data is Willem's data. He is the owner and he will stay the owner. We will bring this data to him and maybe we can offer tools to analyze it, but it is his data and we see it exactly that way. Yeah. We don't sell it to anyone else.
Yeah. If you want to learn more about the MyMesh network protocol or about MyMesh security, on our website chess.nl you can find the download page at products, where you can download white papers about the network protocol and about security.
So maybe some information about what do you expect users will do with the data available, like occupancy data, for instance.
So when we speak about the MyMesh management system, we mentioned that we now have a monitoring and analyzing application of your data. And of course, there's a lot of data coming from the network, but you're not looking for data. You're looking for information because the data which is coming from the network is about burning hours and dimming levels. But you want to know energy consumption. So our MyMesh management system offers you the possibility to have your energy consumption of your building, of your floor, of your room, of your zone, of your device, on the different levels in a time frame you can choose yourself. Second, of course, is that you want status reporting of your devices. Of course, both for sensors and actuators. This information is, of course, used for maintenance purposes and specifically for emergency lighting. This is used to create your digital logbook of your emergency lightings with the reports of the function test and duration test, depending on the compliance standards in your country. The fourth one is the fourth information source is occupancy. Of course, our PIR motion sensors can detect presence and absence, but they also measure the amount of activity in its view. And we call that the triggers, how many triggers you have in a room. And this gives a very good impression of how a room is used. And we can give you a MyMesh management system demo, which with the actual view in our CHESS headquarters. And then you can see how our kitchen is used. And when birthdays are celebrated with cake, when our meeting rooms are occupied, etc., etc. It's very interesting. Of course, the next one is about indoor climate monitoring based on CO2 temperature and relative humidity. And then, of course, it becomes very important that when you look at, for example, CO2 measurements, that you know what kind of PPM levels are healthy and are not healthy anymore. And of course, from there on, you can tune your climate installations or open a window if necessary. Then specifically what we see for horticulture applications, so for vertical farming and greenhouses, we see that light levels are very important for the reports. So the growers know how much light the plants have received. And speaking about this horticulture application, we also see that especially the calendar control application in the management system is used for light recipes in different light spectrums. And you can also imagine, Hanne already spoke about circadian light rhythms, copying daylight. Basically, that works in a similar way, to keep us happy and healthy in our building.
Yeah, and one of the things, we are going to show you in September, because we want to see you all there, about this system is two topics which are hot at the moment, indoor positioning and asset tracking. There are things going on very quickly. Maybe it's interesting to know all our luminaires have a unique GPS location on the world, so you can really navigate to a luminaire. Mm-hmm. We're working on implementation with partners of that, because we don't have to develop these apps. And asset tracking is something, we know the position of the luminaires, they don't move, and if you have a device which is sending our radio signal, we know where you are. Yeah. So all that kind of things are part of this MyMess management system. They're already in, or they are planned to be in the near future.
Yeah, of course, those kind of developments we will do not develop completely by ourselves. So also on this kind of indoor positioning, asset tracking, or indoor navigation, we already have some partnerships in development, to answer Sylvain's question I have on the screen.
Yes, and then there was also a question about cost, the difference between wired and wireless systems. Of course, everything depends on the situation, but in general, when you have an existing situation and you change the lights and want to control them, wireless is by far cheaper than adding new cables. So that's a very easy one. And in situations where you're creating new buildings, of course, there are less costs in cabling, but when everything is new, a few extra wires isn't that expensive. There, the choice for wireless is mostly all of the times is made because you're much more flexible. Today, with this LED luminaires, you know one thing for sure, the lights will remain for 15, 20 years, and your building will change over time in that same period many, many times. So flexibility is the key when you are in a new situation. Wireless is always more effective, more efficient than wired. And one of our listeners, Jack, thinks it's a 10-15% difference in the advantages of wireless. That might be true. We have examples which are even higher, it's saving money when you go wireless.
Yeah. So my experience in calculations for new builds, so new build projects, is that wireless is 10 to 20% cheaper. When it concerns renovation of lighting, you go from conventional fluorescent to LED plus controls, and the customer really wants all the control features implemented, and he has to choose between a wired and wireless system. The savings can be about 30%. Is my experience on the larger projects, where the customer wanted a fully integrated light control solution for the whole venue or for the whole building. So we're getting to the end.
I think so.
Yeah.
Unless there are more questions.
Yeah.
So we have a few minutes left. So if there are questions, this is the moment to ask them. Let's see if there's something coming. No,
I think we've
then we'd like to thank you
very
much for your attendance. Well, it's a nice experience.
Yeah, thanks.
To talk without an audience. Normally you see this response coming from your audience directly. In this case, well, you're all digital.
We're just talking to the camera. So we hope to see you back next time then.
Yeah. And please, if you have any questions, I'm sure you can reach us via the links on our website. So don't hesitate to ask them afterwards.
Yeah. And you can also find both Han and me on LinkedIn to start a chat. Okay.
And maybe one other thing. I think it's interesting to get some feedback on this webinar. What do you think? Was it interesting? Did it work out the way you thought it should be? Maybe you have topics for other webinars. Yep. We'd like to hear.
Okay.
So thank you very much.
Thanks.
And see you later.
Till next time. Bye-bye.
Bye. Okay.